Of course. I mean, I'm looking at your E-Pro right now, your elite prospect. So I was looking at your junior teams, and anytime I can look at a guy who's played for a team that's called the Buckaroos, that's just fantastic. And not only that, there was the Kelowna Buckaroos and the Summerlin Buckaroos. So you got moved and we're still a Buckaroo. That is just fantastic.
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA with your host, Tim Brown, Rob Gilreath, Dustin Lindstrom, and Matt Cavender.
All right, welcome to episode 23 of season 6 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Michigan Tech Hockey Guide, hosted once again from America's Dairyland. I'm Rob Gilreath, your host, and I'm joined this week by Matt Cavender.
You already know who it is.
Tim is out this week with some parental duties, so he won't be joining us this week. But we've got a special guest on this week after running into my dad up at the Hall of Fame game. We've got former Husky forward Sean Harrison. Welcome to the podcast, Sean.
Thanks for having me, you guys.
All right. Well, we'll recap the MTU series with St. Thomas. You know, talk about how Matt's agenda has now been broken by a lack of a sweep there.
Not broken, bruised. Okay.
We'll preview the BSU series a little bit and answer some questions that have come in for Sean. Anything else you want to chat about, Matt?
No, I think that's a great agenda.
All right. We'll be right back after some thank you notes and a brief note from our sponsors.
Whatnot is a social marketplace where you can discover some of your favorite product. If you're in the market for hockey cards and memorabilia, there's no better place than with Psycho Bob TV, Whatnot's original and longest-running hockey channel, which also happens to be run by a Tech alum. Check out his store by going to whatnot.com/invite/PsychoBobTB. Follow on all platforms at PsychoBobTB. That's PsychoBobTB. If you sign up now, you'll get $15 towards purchases on the Whatnot app.
Fibke Dental is a general dentistry practice located in downtown Rhinelander, Wisconsin, home of the Hodag. Look online at FibkeDental.com or find them on Facebook. They do pain-free dentistry for kids, adults, people that went to great schools, and people that ended up at Northern Michigan. Stop in and say hi between 8 and 5 and tell them THG sent you. That is F-I-E-B-K-E Dental.com.
Are you in the market for insurance? Have your rates for home, auto, boat, or more been increasing way beyond inflation? If so, maybe it's time you spoke with Aaron Pietola and the team at Arcadia Insurance Group, serving Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and more. Who better to serve you than a former Michigan Tech player? For more information, call 866-511-1069 or go to arcadiaagency.com.
All right, welcome back, Sean. I think the best way to start off is I listened to your Hall of Fame speech. They put those up online. They're out there for everybody to see. So I took a peek at that to kind of just get a bit of a feel for, you know, what you've gone through there. And your story of how you get to Tech sounds like it might be an interesting one to start with. How did you end up at Tech from BC?
Oh, gosh, you know, Mel Pearson, as I mentioned in my speech, is a very integral part in a little bit of a dance. I was playing junior hockey in BC, and as my understanding was, is that Tech that year had run into some injury woes, and you didn't have the portal back then, so you couldn't just go out and pick somebody up. And they had offered me at the All-Star break when I was playing my last year of junior, and I said no. And I wanted to finish out the year with my team. So that was the first no. The second no came when it was time to sign. And I'd followed somewhat of a childhood dream, actually, to play at the University of Wisconsin. We had family friends. Ron Vincent was a guy that I looked up to in my minor hockey days. And he went to Wisconsin, told me a great story. So that thread continued. And I said no then, because I said yes to Wisconsin.
Sure.
Mel was none too happy. But anyway, persisted. And I had my room assignment. I had everything all set up to go to Wisconsin. And probably looking back in retrospect, it was only about 3 or 4 weeks maximum before I needed to be there. I'd met my roommate, you know, pen pally kind of stuff. And they decided that they were going to go with another direction, blamed it on my scholastics. I went in another direction. And so I, with my tail between my legs, I called Mel Pearson because I now knew that I could play for sure. And I asked him if there was any room. We had a huge class that year. My freshman class had 12 players in it.
Oh, so, yeah, that is a big one.
That was, we had a couple of redshirts in there, Jamie Russell, who ended up being a coach, and Rob Cederberg. Those two guys redshirted that year. But so, yeah, I very circuitous route to get to Tech. And they welcomed me and gave me an opportunity. And it was emotional in my speech because it was about being given another chance. So I dearly am indebted to Mel for his persistence and acceptance. It was fantastic.
Yeah. So what's it like first impressions for, you know, did you do any campus visits or anything like that? Or did you just, you know, set on Wisconsin, right? Is there any campuses above or just a first impression to Tech when you get there the first time?
The very first time I landed, and I did go on other visits to include Wisconsin.
Okay. But,
you know, when I landed in Hancock, it was a great experience because it was a small town. It was beautiful. The weekend games, I got a chance to skate. It was such an overwhelming experience, but it felt cozy and it felt like there was, you know, a good fan base, even though I was exposed to, you know, big bands and, you know, the pep bands and all that kind of stuff elsewhere. I just felt it was probably, you know, a place that the community got behind, and they do. And I felt really honestly at the time, it was pretty selfish. I wanted to play. I didn't want to be a redshirt freshman. And I was told that if I continued on the trajectory of how I was playing, that I would play. So yeah, it was a very close second, obviously, because I ended up there. And again, I go back to Mel on that.
Yeah, that's an interesting way of getting there. And obviously, you know, glad to have you here instead of at Wisconsin, which is the little bit of a rival back in those days.
It was, for sure. We went toe-to-toe with Jeff Sauer's team on lots of occasions. In fact, I played my last game, how ironic, in a Tech uniform in Madison.
Yeah, and that was at the old, you had been playing at Dane County at that point, right? I don't think the Kohl Center, I'm trying to think when the Kohl Center was built, but it definitely wasn't there yet in the early 90s. So
yeah, we're dating myself for sure. It's a long
Dane County is still there. It hosts plenty of stuff in Madison to this day. It hasn't gone away yet.
Yeah, that's where the Capitals play now, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Who plays there?
The Madison Capitals.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Familiar.
Of course. I mean, I'm looking at your E-Pro right now, your elite prospect. So I was looking at your junior teams. And anytime I can look at a guy who's played for a team that's called the Buckaroos, that's just fantastic. And not only that, there was the Kelowna Buckaroos and the Summerland Buckaroos. So you got moved and we're still a Buckaroo. That is just fantastic.
Some of the greatest times actually ran into, junior hockey is such an electric thing. And I was there as a 16-year-old with the Kelowna Buckaroos. Quite a while in the junior ranks, it racked up some points and finally, like I said, got that chance. But we were sold, moved just down the lake and to a small town and had a great run there. We were very competitive still. And, again, just an opportunity to go out and play. So, but Buckaroos is a, yeah. There's lots of fun with that.
Yeah, I was only familiar with the Portland Buckaroos in Portland, Oregon, who were there for a little bit. I didn't know there was even more out west just hockey teams named that way. That's pretty fun.
There's been
a bunch of cowboys out west, right?
Oh yeah, of course.
There's been a BC connection with Tech for a while. I mean, a lot of the players have come out of the BCHL. It was the BCJHL, I think, when you were playing, but it's the same league, I believe, right? The BCHL is kind of the successor. Yeah. You were in Penticton as well, which is, I think, where Alex Patan played before he came to Tech and several others. So it's there's a little bit of history there with BC players coming all the way to Tech.
There is a pipeline for sure. And, the base of it all, I think, and then, you know, referring other people or staying in the community. I always speak highly of Tech. It was, something that I carry quite dearly. It was such a wonderful thing, trajectory to get on from there. there's lots of pipeline back here. Kip Noble, I've talked to him quite frequently. Jamie Russell had reached out to him. A lot of teammates, if they're close by, but all BC boys, right? So That's there's a great thread there, and there's been some really good players that come out of have come out of here.
Yeah, and when you started playing, it was I believe you're under Herb Boxer the entire time, right? He was the coach for all 4 years, the head coach. Is that correct with that? What was he like as a coach? We don't hear a lot. You're one of the first players from the kind of this era, so it's kind of interesting to chat about. You know, we talk about players that played under McGinnis or players that played under Russell and such, but we don't get a lot of first guy we've talked to under Herb. So can you kind of give us any stories about him at all?
Oh gosh.
And remember, it is recorded too, right? So
yeah, no, you know what? Herb and I didn't pull any punches now, and I won't pull any about him. I thought that he was under the gun from the very beginning. Right. I mean, we didn't have a lot of wins under our belt under his regime, and you know, Mel was there, Bruce Horsch, Darcy Way. Those are the core guys that coached. And at any one time, Doug Harris was also, Russ Becker, Dave Roach, you know, they all passed through if they were going to spend some extra time at Tech going to school. It was by committee. Herbie was a pretty, you know, staunch guy, right? But old school. And the game was changing. The game was going, you know, faster, bigger, a little bit more tactile, more coaching, right? So, I don't know what kind of tactician he was. I just put my head down, and if he put me out there, which he did a lot, he trusted me to do it, and I trusted him to steer it. But it wasn't always roses, right? Like,
yeah,
you know, it's a love-hate relationship, because I really wanted to win. I wanted to help the team, and I wanted to succeed, and we didn't get a real good chance on that. And it's easy to blame the coach, but yeah, Herbie had his time.
Yeah, and you guys, we're playing the old WCHA. Is there any particular road trips or series that stick out to you as being, you know, impactful ones, or ones that you enjoyed more than others with you know, the teams you're playing?
We had a great opportunity to go to play Hockey East.
That's one thing I wanted to touch on at some point, so I'm glad you're bringing it up.
Right. So we head out to Boston, and there's some stuff that can't be told, like, you know.
Sure.
Down the turnpike a little ways, get back to the airport on the way out, Logan Airport. We had some freedom out there. It was great to be in a big American city for a lot of us.
Sure, sure.
We went to the Bombay Bicycle Club, and I think a few of us hitched a ride on a bridesmaid's kind of.
Sure.
So, yeah, we were down the turnpike, I don't know, like 20, 30 miles. It was crazy.
So you just crashed a bachelorette party, is what you're saying?
It was a bachelorette party. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. We're in a limo.
Oh, that's good stuff. Yeah. It's been a while since Tech has played. I'd have to imagine. I mean, playing Boston College last year in the tournament is probably one of the first times we've played them since you guys did. There's not that much overlap there scheduling wise. So there was a few years there where that interlocking schedule existed. You guys went to places that Tech teams haven't gone to for a very long time. New Hampshire, Maine, you know, yeah. And Boston itself. So what was how did you guys travel out there for that? Did you guys fly or bus, or what did you guys actually do?
We did fly commercial.
Yeah, sure.
But like today, everyone's taking their own stuff. I don't know. Yeah, we flew commercial. Okay. That was some of the fun times too. I mean, there was enough flying going on during that time that we got frequent flyer points. I have a number of stories about that, but you know, we'd fly pretty much anywhere, right? We'd go out to Colorado, we'd go out to Denver, two trips. That's once a year. You know, the one going to Alaska was really kind of cool.
Yep. Yeah. You guys played up in Anchorage too. I saw from the look in there, and some, it was like a Nissan Jeep tournament or something like that Anchorage put on, I guess.
Exactly. Yeah. The Nanoose and all of those two teams, they've had some good players too. Reed McDonald's from there, and he played just shortly with me and then after me.
I believe he's the one that owns a brewery up there now, I think, if I remember right.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
I've been to that brewery. It's a good one.
Have you?
I have. Yeah.
Did you check in with Rito?
I didn't, I don't know if he was there the day we were there. Tech has done a couple of back-to-backs over Thanksgiving when Anchorage and Anchorage and the Nooks were in the same league with us. And we went up, I went up for two of those and, you know, had Thanksgiving dinner up there with a buddy of mine that was the PA announcer for the Nanooks. So yeah, we've gone up to Alaska as well. It's a great trip. It's fun up there.
So we'd be on the plane enough that we actually started doing the stewardess gig, all of us. So 20 of us are in the seat. Almost, you know, the plane's not quite full with just us, but you know, so we'd go through the whole routine, you know, fasten your buckle and you know,
sure.
All this stuff. And everyone just howling, right? The dollar trick when you're at the gate and, you know, the night before, on the way home mostly, tired, Minneapolis airport, thread tied to a $10 bill and people bending over and grabbing it and you yank it. And we had the whole, I don't know, couple of gates just howling, watching us do that for a while. That was on the way to Alaska, actually, on the way back.
Sure. Yeah.
Man, this is...
We didn't have any kind of fun.
There weren't cell phones back then, everybody just stared at, right? So you had to make something else up to get along with it through the airport time.
That's true. But also, like, I think about even my time at Tech, if you think about the community, like, it's like you said, it's not a big city, even though you guys are coming from places like BC, you're not getting, it's not a whole lot different. It's a lot of having to make your own fun. It's not like there's like a fun park or there's, you know, it's a lot of having to make your own fun there. And that just sounds to me like a lot of making your own fun in that kind of a situation. It's did it in spades with that story.
You know, there's a lot of mischievous guys.
No, I've never seen,
you know,
that.
In adult bodies, but have children for minds who, I mean, I could name a few on the roster, but, you know, I might be one of them. I don't know. We had a lot of fun. No doubt about it. I mean, you know, I thought I was going to go offside. I know this is probably a family thing. So, you know, we didn't want to go too far down the bachelorette program.
Yeah, we're probably going to call it a bachelorette party and sticking around there.
It was nice to get up to those cities. And it's a shame. Budgets or alignment and conferences. I mean, they never really leave the state of Michigan, really, right?
No, yeah, it's a bit frustrating to kind of see the way it's changed a bit. I mean, I grew up watching Wisconsin and Minnesota come into the McGinnis, and you know the TV cameras would show up for the Wisconsin series and and the Minnesota series to put it on TV, and that just doesn't happen anymore with, you know, the way the Big Ten's broke up. That said, I think we've done all right with what we've had to do over the last few years. I also haven't missed a, you know, NCAA game because we've been going to those again. So. Right. What's kind of your impression of the program as an alum? You know, it's the first time you've been back in a while, it sounds like, right? What are your kind of thoughts about where the program's at today?
It's leaps and bounds ahead of where we were. You know, I mean, we had, as far as the facilities go, you know, the boxes and the, it's a really, you know, well-oiled run machine now, and it comes from funding and I think probably setting the tone. Mel, from my perspective, you know, getting the program back on the winning track precipitates lots of other things, right? That are good. We had, you know, decent dressing room, a sauna, a place to shower and so forth, but we didn't have a jacuzzi or a cold plunge or,
sure,
you know, can't go too in depth into that, but really like what I saw when I was there for the induction. I, you know, come a long way from where we were. It was like a municipal rink, more or less. Good bones, as they say, and it looks like it may grow again, right? Blow the back wall out and do that kind of thing. But it's nice to see some advancement for sure, not only on the ice, but in the facilities. So, even that was a draw when I was there in 86, but tenfold now. I suspect to be competitive and draw players, you need all of those tools.
Yeah, and they've done, like you said, the bones of the McGinnis are fantastic. I love the steep seating. You go to a newer rink and you don't feel like you're watching the game in the same place as you can in the McGinnis. It's great.
Yeah, I've always loved how in the MAC, it feels like if you take one false step, you're falling on the ice and one of the boys is going to hit you. Like, that's
pretty steep. It's pretty steep.
We've heard from other players that being in the McInnes when you've got like all the fans on top of you is just, it creates an atmosphere that's hard to replicate just anywhere else.
Really is. I mean, I did play, you know, some other games, obviously for other teams where the atmosphere was, you know, electric, but it's a great rink, right? The sight lines are great. There's no, you are close. Right. And, you know, wrapping around the glass at the end now is kind of a cool thing. I remember, you know, Cheryl DePoit is always stood in the corner, you know, like,
sure.
You know, you would get to see and recognize people and they'd recognize you back. Right. Larger venues don't afford you that kind of familiarity. You know, I really loved playing there. It was good. You know what? It was pretty good ice, too.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the your big season, right? You are the only Tech player to have the scoring title in the WCHA, even through all the championship teams, you know, all the earlier teams in the WCHA. You're the only guy in the original WCHA to be the scoring champ from Tech. There's two other guys that do it after you in, I don't want to say watered down, but I will say watered down WCHA later. But what's that season like where you're just putting in goal after goal after goal?
There was a time there where Randy McKay, who was my right winger, and Brian Hannon, my left winger, where we were, and I think for that year, we were in all special situations. I killed penalties. I was on the power play and I took a regular shift. So the three of us were the highest scoring line in college hockey that year. So that allowed, for lots of things to happen. And we got on a roll. Herb put us together and we got hot one weekend and we had like 4 or 5 points, I think. We'd have to check the stats, but we got hot and we just stayed together. And it was kind of a nice way of playing, because I said it in my speech too, and anyone I talked to, is that Randy would go get it, right? He'd bang someone hard enough to, shake it loose or give it to me, and Brian would find a way to get open. And if he wasn't open, I'd shoot it and maybe I'd get a goal. But we were constantly on the attack, and it was, we had three guys who could do specific things really well, and Brian could shoot the puck like nobody had seen, and Randy was just a force. He was always around the puck, which made it easier for me. I just became the guy who could distribute the puck. So it was pretty amazing stuff, right? I mean, we, as a line, had great success. And we talked about it that weekend. It was emotional, because it was, Randy said I set him up for his pro career that way. Because that's
sure.
That's the kind of player he was, even when he was a pro. So
yeah, he had a heck of a long career too. I think I'm almost positive he's the number one in games played for a Tech alum. So he was a mainstay in the NHL for years.
Yeah, he was a force for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, part of the Devils teams that's why I've seen the Stanley Cup in person. It's when he's brought it back. So
yeah.
When
I was there that weekend, Randy and I hung out.
Nice.
My boys were there. We watched the Green Bay game, and had some stew and reminisced about stuff and saw the memorabilia in his office with the two Stanley Cups. And yeah, really kind of neat to rekindle with him. He's a big part of what was happening back in our day.
Yeah. Well, where were you guys living when you were on campus at that point? I mean, top McGinnis folks talk about being down in the, the dorms or whatever, not in the dorms, but in the huts down on the ice. At that point, I don't think that was in existence anymore. Were you guys up in the dorms actually, or did you guys were you off campus?
Well, first year was mandatory that we spent a year in the dorm.
Okay.
My roommate, Frank Ferlin, our freshman goalie, part of the 12-man freshman class from Nanaimo, BC.
Sure.
Yeah. So that was 1 year. And then everyone dispersed. There was some over at the, in Hancock. There was, houses all over the place. But Rob Tustian, his parents had a place directly across from campus. It's the Yellow House now there.
Okay.
There's an organization that's in there.
Yeah, I think there actually is. I think that's I'm trying to think. But yeah, there is something. I know
there's
exactly
some organization that is in the house that I lived in 3 years there.
Yes, I know the house you're talking. I'm going to see if I can find it.
You guys are directly across from campus, right? Yeah. That's easy.
That was walking distance. The front yard turned into a parking lot for all the hockey guys and non hockey guys.
Sure.
So that they could just park there and then walk to campus. Yeah, very fortunate. It was kind of a fun place. Well, it was more than a fun place.
Oh yeah, it's my duplex was next to some hockey guys too, so we had good times. my senior year as well.
We threw some pretty good parties, I can say that.
Yep. Yeah, there was never a shortage of someone to help you drink beer next door. Let's just put it that way.
No, the tap's on.
Yep. Yeah. Being next to campus like that's super convenient. It's fantastic. Let's see, who do we got from a listener question? Oh, Tim's put one in our chat here. I'll grab that one real quick before I don't want to forget listener questions, because we try to avoid that.
Kind of need those.
Yep. They help, right? So Robert LaFave wants to know, what is your most memorable moment as a Husky, either off ice or on ice or both? We can do one of each.
I'd say my favorite memory of on the ice was a time when, it kind of sounds weird, but anyway, I had told Doug Harris's wife, Monica, that I was going to score off the draw. And before the game, like days before, because I've been trying it in practice. And so I did it. And I looked over and she was in the corner, like I said about Cheryl. again, another closeness thing. And I just looked at her and I gave her a wink and it was like, I told you so.
Sure.
So that was what I like to call in flow. So I called my shot. So that's my most memorable for me, like a personal thing.
Sure. Sure. That's awesome though. That's your own Babe Ruth moment.
Yeah. It was weird, man. Cause the whole thing was in slow mo. It was weird. Yeah. Hope that answers the question.
Oh yeah.
That's perfect. Yeah. Yeah.
They're always good.
Do we have any other listener questions right now?
Yeah. Listener, I don't think there's too many of those. They're talking about the fins now. Is what the Discord's off on right now.
Yeah, so that's what we're doing.
There you go.
Yeah. Well, that's a big change too. What do you think of tech pulling a little more of the international crew in? You know, it used to be Canadians and Americans for the most part, and you didn't see a lot of European players in college hockey, but it's shifted a little bit. What's kind of your thoughts on that as a former player?
Well, I don't take exception to it. I think it there's good players and the game is truly global. So having said that, you know, the roster and so many things again have to go, you know, line up in order for you to find yourself in Houghton, Michigan. You know, like there's yeah. so many things. Is there not the argument could be made, is there not an equally as good player within the local market, let's say, or a state over, or, you know, or. And I think it also depends on what level the organization is at. There was lean years, like you had said, and then things come along and things progress and you start winning. Those all those players didn't come from BC.
Yeah, sure. Well, some of them did.
Yeah. But that was the thing, you know, like it was a big deal for us, for Canadian kids to get a US-based college scholarship. I would suggest that message is being sent from every corner of the globe now that plays hockey at any level.
Well, and with the recent changes with the CHL stuff as well, I think, you know, we're seeing it with a lot of commits coming out of there now. So, you know, players that may have been cut off from the NCAA system are being able to get their second chance to come and go back to school or go to school instead after, you know, playing some CHL games. So yeah. it's we're on another little change in the recruiting, it feels like,
things
right
have
now.
Changed. Yeah, things have changed so much. I mean, I remember, you know, going to a tier one CHL level team when I was 16 or 17, trying to make the team then. I was lucky. They said, don't do it. Go the U.S. college route.
Yeah, right.
Develop there, et cetera, right? So that we needed to make that decision before I played an exhibition game. That's all erased.
Yep.
So you're going to get, and the landscape of hockey's dramatically changed with even within Team Canada or, you know, Canada Hockey, right? Like it's really just in a churn right now. No one knows what level you're actually at. Right.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how that settles out. I do appreciate the fact that it feels like to me you're not punishing a 16 or 15 year old for making that decision, playing that one or two games, and cutting him off from the university system. It's a good choice for the students, I think.
Yeah, I think that's the great divide right there. That and I'll take from it anyway is that there's the community, there's the fans, right, and then it's a business. So. Yep. You know, that happens all too frequently, obviously, in the pro game. These guys are pros, right? Like, they're one step away from the elite pro, but realistically, in my opinion, the rigors that we went through and then throw academics on top of that would bear a lot of weight to tell me that every person that plays in the NCAA at the Division I level is a pro, right?
Yep.
So, yeah, it allows for an assembly of a different kind of lineup, right, with all kinds of different nationalities involved. I always thought that the Finnish guys, you know, were foreign. So.
Yeah. Well, they fit in a little bit back in Houghton.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
They're well received by the community.
Well, and there have been some, right? The Pietola guys are, you know, have been very good.
Yeah. Well, the Pietolas, they pronounce it five different ways depending on where you're from.
Exactly.
It's a good one there. They've all got the Finnish background coming from downstate. And then you've got actual Finns that are coming over now. I mean, we've got, I think there's what I saw a picture from, how was it, last weekend or the weekend before, where they were out on the ice with the Finnish national flag celebrating Finnish Independence Day. So they had they had all of them out there on the ice together with the flag. It was kind of neat to see.
It is neat. International flavor, I think, is good for the game.
Yeah, agreed. It's really neat to see it, and And there's definitely that special connection with the Keweenaw and Finland. So it works itself out well in the end. One of the interesting things looking at the schedule of games you played too, speaking of international flavor, and it's the only time I've seen that name. You guys played an exhibition game against a Russian team 1 year. It looked like
that's right.
Dynamo Moscow.
Yep.
For a game.
I don't know how that all came together. Yeah, so that was very, very interesting because it was near the end of my time. And so you kind of get an advanced look at on the international side anyway, because we went and had a cup of coffee with the Canadian national team, Kip and I did.
Oh, okay.
And so you saw the same guys from that game on the Russian team that we played.
Sure. Oh, gotcha.
Right. So Samak and a few other guys that were, you know, hovering and staying within the program for the next Olympics, which would have been 92 for us.
Okay.
So it was kind of neat. Like, I don't know how it all came together, but that was one thing I remember for sure. And they were all highly skilled, right? I mean, it was, if there was a weakness on our club, it was exposed rather quickly. Yeah. Those guys were pros, right? So
sure. Yeah. Yeah. I remember Tech playing the Czechoslovak team a couple of times as a kid, but I don't remember the Moscow game, but looking back at the list of games there, I was kind of surprised to see that one pop out there. So I knew we'd played some Eastern Bloc teams there early when I was young, but I didn't realize we'd played a Russian team. So it's kind of neat. Do you know if anybody on that team went on to play any farther? I mean, that's right around the time when, you know, folks start coming over, not too far from that.
Well, you know, I'd have to check the roster again, but
sure.
Like I said, Samak was a guy that absolutely okay. did.
Yeah.
He's the one guy that stuck out because he was my Czech.
Sure.
So I got to know him pretty personally.
Gotcha. Well, you know, you said you and Kip did the Canadian national team. You did play a few games for Team Canada, right?
Yeah, we played three each. It was like, it was an interesting thing at the end of the year. They wanted to see, so there was an assembly of college guys.
Okay.
So college guys were, you know, asked to come out. It was more of an evaluation, right? Because it would have been at least 1 year out from reporting to Calgary for the Olympic team at that time, right? That would have been the last year before the pros came in.
Gotcha. Okay, sure.
So the college guys got a swing and Kip and I were chosen. Got a phone call. Hey, do you want to go? Can you come? Got the sign off from Ted Curley at that time. Yeah, go ahead.
Sure.
Right? So yeah, it was amazing. It was through the Maritimes.
Oh, okay. So you went out east and played for a bit then?
Yeah.
And so you get to go from end to end of Canada with hockey. That's not too shabby.
No, it was pretty cool. The only place I haven't been, Newfoundland. I'm going sometime soon.
Yeah, that's the last there province you got left.
The last frontier, man.
Yeah. You're a dialect of English that sounds closer to Ireland than what you're talking to us with right now.
At least I'm speaking the Queen's English. I'm not sure that many Newfies speak any kind of English. Just saying.
Probably not. Probably no, not.
Just saying.
They're notorious for their accent.
In a good way. We love you guys.
I don't know. We're going to have to ask Tim to pull up the analytics. Do we have any listeners? We got listeners in like India. There's got to be someone in Newfoundland.
Yeah, let's have Tim look. I don't know. I'm trying to think if Tex had any players from the Maritimes. There's got to be at least one, I would imagine. But it's always been Western Canada for the most part in, you know, Ontario.
Yeah, that's how
Tech draws from. Yeah.
We'll get some like players' parents and stuff doing that kind of stuff. We see you, but
yeah,
we'll have to see if anyone in Newfoundland is doing that or somewhere out there.
A little fiction in fact from the Chase McNaughton podcast.
Yeah. Yeah. We try to have a little bit of research up on the screen, but I don't have that level of detail to look at. Tim is our spreadsheet guy. He's got, he could just do a quick look and find.
Oh, he's a database lookup guy, is he?
Oh, he's 100 a database guy. Yeah, he's got
in his brain 20. Or actually on the computer?
On the computer. It's all stored. Okay. He writes it down.
Nice. That's great.
Well, you got any other any kind of other stories you want to share? I guess we'll give you an open floor here for any.
Oh my gosh, I got open.
You
mic.
Got that you want to throw
open
out there.
Mic time.
Yeah.
I'm having a blast. I really love talking hockey and like talking different perspective. You know, all of these things have been just wonderful. I do appreciate how we got here.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a humorous
thing. Things had to line up. It was kind of cool. I was down there with Daver.
Yeah,
Karnowski's there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so just before we were going out, and ran into your dad there, and he was like, "Oh yeah, well, what do you think?" And then I got your text. It was fantastic.
Sure.
Yeah.
So you were down. You were down at the waiting to go up for the Hall of Fame stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was running back from the blue line room then. I know what he was
there
doing.
There you go.
Yep. Ever between the periods is going to the blue line room, and then that's going back. My mom and dad have had the same season tickets in section G on the end there by the Zamboni door since they bought season tickets. So,
you know what? I probably have a flashback and see them on the glass. Who knows? It's, like I said, it's kind of a funny barn that way.
Yep. Yeah. It's I love the place. I haven't been up there this year yet. It's frustrating to not have made it up yet this year, but it's been a busy fall. That's one of the biggest regrets I have about living 4 hours south is I can't go to home games.
There you go. Catch it on the road. That's very cool. I don't know. You know, like I just said, happy or Merry Christmas for all those who celebrate, and happy holidays. I'm honored and quite grateful to be on with the podcast. It's my virgin podcast.
So, you've been
put
great.
Put that down. It's never live it down now.
It's fantastic. Yeah, it's been something we've been doing for a while. We enjoy it. We love getting stories out of folks. It's a ton of fun. I mean, I couldn't imagine, you know, sitting down and chatting with everybody we've chatted with, and we love getting older players on that can tell their stories about what Tech was like during, you know, their little slice that they were there, right?
Well, you guys are archiving and we're making history as we speak on here. So both you, Matt and Rob, and sorry for the chance not to get to meet, what was his name?
Tim. Tim's the other one, yeah.
Tim, yeah. So, cool.
All right. Well, appreciate it, Sean. Have a Merry Christmas yourself as well out there. Hopefully you guys are done with the storms here for a bit. You had a nice, hot, solid one there a week or two ago, I believe, right? So
we had a little bit of a downpour affect some of our projects, so we'll see how it goes.
A little bit of a blow.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we appreciate it, Sean. Well, Matt and I will stay on here a bit and chat about the current team, and have a good rest of your night.
Thank you so much. Good night, you guys.
Thanks for coming, Sean. It was a pleasure.
Take care.
Thanks.
All right. Water break.
Yeah, and we're going to mute this time so Tim doesn't
yell. We're going to mute this time just for Tim.
We're muting Tim. We're muting Tim.
Watch this. Watch this.
Muted.
We fund everything at Tech Hockey Guide from listeners like you. You can show your support by becoming a patron at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Whether you're interested in question priority, access to patron-only Zoom chats with coaches and players, instat deep dives, extended versions of the podcast, unedited video or audio, early access, or commercial-free listening, there's a level for you. We also now have 15% discounts off annual memberships with tiers ranging from $2 to $50 per month. Again, sign up at patreon.com/techhockeyguide.
Do you work in manufacturing, product design, or product development? Is your business trying to improve efficiency while also producing at scale? Livonia Technical Services can help. They provide world-class quality improvement training and consulting for failure modes and effect analysis, product development, and cost reduction. All things that could help Northern Michigan assemble a competent defense. If you think your business could use a prevention mindset and reduce manufacturing costs, a partnership with Livonia Technical Services might be right for you. Check them out at livoniatech.net. That's LIVONIA tech.net.
All right, well, I'm back.
I got a wardrobe change here now because that was way too warm. Having a sweater and a work polo on, way too much underneath.
Can't be doing that.
No. Much, much better now. All right. Well, I suppose we can get her back going here. Well, I just figured we'd talk about the chat a little bit about St. Thomas, talk a little bit about BSU, anything else?
I think that's probably a good way to start rounding it out. Maybe take another half hour or something like that.
Yeah, see what she is.
See where it goes. When we say half hour, probably be another hour being here, but that's the way it is. That's right. How we do things here. So I feel like it's important for me to start this one.
You could fire this off because you've been getting slagged a bit in different channels.
So I mean, first of all, I self-admitted a lot of things. So first of all, Friday was just a great hockey game. That was just a fun, it was a come from behind game even, you know, nice to see some fight back in the team and come away. I was really impressed with what I saw Friday. Saturday is just unfortunate. I feel like I feel like there was a lot of that game where the team just looked tired and like couldn't really get into it. And I said this in the game thread and, you know, I have to give St. Thomas their flowers. I took them for complete and total pretenders. And I think with that series, they tell me they're not. I am not ready to give up on the agenda. Reason being, while I no longer believe them to be the complete pretender that I have been taking them for the entire season, I still think this is a long shot from a consensus number one. So the agenda still stands for me for the time being, but is still subject to change. It was not a great weekend for the agenda, admittedly, but I consider it to be bruised and not broken.
Yeah, the Friday night game, you know, felt like to me like it could have gone either way, right? I mean, we got I think we got lucky to pull a win out on that one, which is great. Big fan of a team that can win games that you don't feel like they're gonna win, right?
Yeah.
So that was awesome to see them pull the game out there. And then you go into Saturday where I missed the first period. I had to watch it on double speed because I trusted CHN's times. And, you know, they said it was a 7 o'clock game and it wasn't. So I realized I was missing the game after getting some text messages. So watched the first period on 2x speed on Midco while catching up and kind of fast forwarding through bits, which I will say Midco worked fantastic for that. I've got to give props to the streaming service for how well it worked to go back in time again during a live broadcast, change the speed and watch it at a 2x speed. It worked really, really well for that. So I was more than happy to see that I could catch up, if you will. And what a crappy way to end the period and kind of give them the life that they needed to kind of sustain themselves with that second goal. Just
absolutely killer. Absolutely killer. I feel like that was where where the game got lost. To be honest. Like, you can't.
Why not? I don't know. You go into a second period. Look at the second period, though. We dominated them in the second period, but just couldn't score. And it's been a frustrating story for tech teams for years to just not be able to put the puck in the net sometimes when we are dominating like that.
That's what you call a classic tech loss right there, where it's kind of a classic tech weekend in a way, where you win the game you don't really expect to and lose the one you kind of feel like you should. But that's the way of the land. You know, the big story for me is that I feel like that is some big time lifeblood for St. Thomas. If they wouldn't have come away with any wins this weekend, I think they might have been, I think that would have deflated the room. We might have been talking with them in the same conversation as Ferris and Northern this season. I think there was a good chance that they could have cratered in terms of just like locker room morale had that happened. And I think this can very well be a point where it starts to bounce back because their schedule does start to get easier.
Yep. Well, the biggest thing I think that frustrates me from the game we lost too is that that's the second week in a row where we've had a 5-minute major and we're not able to capitalize on it enough in my mind. Right.
It was nice to at least capitalize once. Upon.
Yeah,
I agree that it's when I see a 5-minute major, I see you can score as many times as you want, one man up, and nobody has the authority to stop you. And I understand wanting to set up for the best shot available because, you know, I'm one of those guys that gets frustrated when some guy yells shoot and there's nowhere to shoot as well. I get it.
Yep.
I get it. But sometimes you do have to take a B-minus shot instead of the A-plus one you keep trying to look for, you know? You just have to take what's given to you sometimes and try to bang in a shitty goal. It's going to go up on the board the same as between the legs and top shelf, you know, just banging it, you know?
Yep.
It's the time to just crash the net and get an ugly one, you know?
Yep. Especially when, where we're getting as many shots as we are and they're just not going in, you know, maybe those little scrappy ones will get things chugging. But no, I don't know. It's one of those weekends where I feel like we should have got more points and,
trust me, you act like I don't feel that way.
Yeah, right. Yeah, to hold them to a single shot in a period and not score a goal is just, it's frustrating to see that. just frustrating to see it. And then give up the empty netter after, I don't understand, and I'm with Joe on this one. I don't get how that wasn't an ice on the shot that goes over the net.
He was hot about that one, and I feel like rightfully so. That kind of... That didn't seem...
Yeah, I mean, the idea, from what I understand, not a ref or a linesman, but if there is somebody below the dots already when the puck is iced and there's, you know, no chance for them to get it, to have any way to wave it off, and I don't think you can argue that a shot going over the net is something that somebody who's, you know, down low like that has any chance of stopping in any way. So there's no reason in my mind to wave that off because they're down there. I don't get how that's not an icing immediately Did he get beat to the puck? Sure, but he was already below the dots. Why do you need to race to it at that point? You're low enough that it's supposed to be an ice, in my understanding of the rule.
Yeah, and hybrid icing, I feel like, is the best thing that's been added to the game in the last decade, because before that, you had touch-up icing, and that's when you were getting a whole bunch of guys just getting absolutely stapled. And then at the youth leagues, you were having no-touch icing, where as soon as it got down there, no matter what, even if you were close, it is an icing. So it's very nice to kind of
dribble across, and it was still an ice. Yeah.
This, to me, was one of the most fair compromises that has been made. And the one thing that can get kind of frustrating is that, like, ties go to the defense, but I feel like that's an aside of the point of this play, is that I don't like the call.
Yep,
that's all I can really say about it.
That was a frustrating one to see, for sure.
I don't like it. I don't agree with it, but it's tough, because while I agree with Joe and I don't feel like I would have gotten any less hot than he did, I remember, and again, remember, I'm playing hockey that's far below what any of these guys did, but whenever I would have a coach lose his mind like that, I almost took it as permission for me to lose my mind. And that is,
sure.
Don't know what the player's response to that is in the moment, but that's how I would feel when that would happen to me, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's always interesting to see that. And you do wish that maybe it didn't happen that way, but it is what it is. And I get why you're heated in the moment. I think he did a good job of the interview afterwards, where he's calmed down and, you know, refocused himself back on it. So
we
it was good,
do need
good
to talk quite a bit about the evolution of Joe Sean's media literacy, because
sure,
absolutely, he's gotten a lot better, because he's rough around the edges. That's a reason a lot of Tech fans have become really endeared to him, but he has become a lot more strategic in the way he's taught, especially when you get a hot moment like that. And I agree, he did kind of dial it in the post game comments a little better.
Yeah. Yep. So anyways, that was last series, right? Split, unfortunate, should have been in my mind a sweep, but now we move on, and
it's a good Bemidji team.
Go play Bemidji, right?
It's so a good Bemidji.
They are just under, .500 in terms of record, for pairwise record, right? We're just over it. So it should be a good series. They're coming off of a win against North Dakota, which is always something to hang your hat on a little bit, right? A tie, I mean, and a win, right?
So Bemidji is just over .500, both overall and in conference. I just want to
throw I'm looking at the CHN thing where they've got pairwise record. I think one of those wins is an OT win or something like that, maybe.
I gotcha. Yeah.
That doesn't count pairwise-wise. So potato stats wise.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, we're not quite at the point where pairwise, well,
no, we don't need to care.
Yeah, it's not even start that one.
No. So last game against Bemidji is a fairly important one, right? CCHA championship. We haven't played them yet this year. And they seem to be doing all right this year, but a little up and down, it feels like to me, looking at their schedule.
I feel like I say this too often about a lot of teams, but Bemidji is the one I feel the most strongly this about, is that they just always, I feel like Michigan Tech and Bemidji State always seem to walk kind of like step in step as to what's happening in the CCHA. And I kind of feel the same way this year. They've got some high highs. They've got some low lows, and I feel like they're still trying to piece together who they are as a team. They're having the season thus far that, no, I can't say that, because I picked Tech to be number one until the Pitlick pick, but this is a standard Tech beginning of the season, like historically, is what I'm looking at with this Bemidji State start. They are another team that I feel like hits their stride at the half and then finishes strong, and I feel like this could be
they have yet to pull off their own sweep this year, but they've been swept only once by St. Cloud, and that's including games, like I said, against North Dakota and Minnesota State and Minnesota State. So there's
Augustana, who I would still consider to be better than we give them credit for.
Yeah.
That's the other half of the agenda that we can't forget.
Right. But to, you know, get a split with Minnesota as well as split with North Dakota, a split and a tie, right? So they took North Dakota to a tie. I don't know. Let's see here. Did they actually
do
a shootout in that one or not? I'm not sure whether they did that.
Let's look at the box score.
I don't see anything in the box on CHN for it, so I don't know if they.
I'm looking at their school site, so I'm not seeing anything there either. Yeah, no, I'm not seeing anything there either.
But I mean, that's a game that they were up 3-2 and let let UND come back, and looks like a fairly even, at least from shots perspective, third period. A split with North Dakota's, this may be a down year for them, but anytime you can split with them is good. And
take it to the bank, especially comparisons against NCHC teams.
Split in Minnesota, they seem to be doing all right this year.
I would say they are a team that I've said several times on this podcast already, I fully expect to be in the Frozen Four. So taking one from them, especially in 3-1 fashion, is that's great stuff for the Beavers.
Well, they've got two losses on the year, and one of them is Bemidji. So that's a heck of a win, for Bemidji to pull off there. So I don't know. I think this weekend's going to be a tough one. It always is, and this one is in Bemidji, right? So it's the long, boring bus ride for sure. But I don't know. What are your thoughts on actual results here? I'm going to go and say I'm going to call a split.
I'm going to call it a split, and usually I'm bold enough to try to give a score or try to tell who's going to win both nights, but I just feel like it's always such a chess match against Bemidji, like every time, that I just don't feel confident enough either way to say which one's going to be the win, which one's going to be the loss, what the score is going to be like. It just feels like when these two teams get together, it's all on the table. Like, not quite to the extent that I feel like it is with Northern, because I feel like with Northern, we can throw any stats or anything away because it's just pure rivalry. This is one where I feel like it's such a chess match between two teams that play a very similar game that it's tough to call. And I do feel like, Bemidji has had far and away the tougher schedule, but I do find these teams to be, as always, very comparable. So it's going to be a fun weekend. Maybe not quite as I would consider the top flight of watching CCHA hockey to be Tech versus Mankato, where we got swept, but I feel like it's up there. It's going to be a very fun series to watch.
Yeah, I agree. I'm looking forward to it for sure. It's
no
always
place for a nervous person, but fun.
It's a fun place to go watch a game too. I mean, I'm a big fan of going up to Bemidji. It's a fun town. I've been up there twice now, and I don't hate it. I just hate getting there.
Getting there does kind of suck, and Sanford is probably class of the league in terms of facilities. It's very nice.
Yep. Yeah, agreed. It's nice and connected there too with
the hotel right there.
With the hotel right there, right? So
not so far away from downtown or my boy Babe the Blue Ox.
Yeah. Yep. He is there as well.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Do we got anything else to kind of chat about? I mean, I don't have too much. I don't know, around the league. Do we got anything to summarize up there? This is the first weekend I've not really watched any condensed games yet. I usually try to watch a couple other ones around the league, but I didn't do that this week at all.
It was bachelor party weekend for me, so I didn't do too much either.
Sure.
My bachelor party was pretty calm. It was actually exactly what I wanted. We went paintballing, then we went to the Wings game, and that was it.
Nice.
It was a good time.
That does not sound like a bad time at all.
It was exactly what I want. I know that when I started talking to Abigail, I was at Papsiak's house, and I put this in the Discord. But sure. just for fun, we had a vanilla Coke Everclear.
Oh, yeah, Wisconsin, I saw that. I didn't realize there was a difference.
Yeah, in Wisconsin, you can sell 190 proof Everclear. You can't sell that in Michigan. It tops out at 151 here, so we had to have Michigan Everclear. So close as we could get, but
I did know it was 151 because I have or have not used that before. In a cooler at said senior house. So
yeah,
it was definitely a mixer at times. I do think pretty much the rest of the games went, a lot of them went the way you'd expect, right? Around the league, Ferris State swept Northern, Bemidji split with Lake Superior, and
Bowling Green took Minnesota State to overtime on Saturday.
Took five out of six, right? So
yep, correct.
Yeah. All right. Well, we got anything else? If not, I think that'll wrap her for this week.
Yeah, we'll not circle around to those sore topics, and we'll call it a day.
All right.
1 minute remaining in the podcast.
Well, that'll do it for this episode of the Chasing McNaughton podcast. You can support Michigan Tech Hockey Guide becoming a Patreon. Check out all the tiers at patreon.com/techhockeyguide, including student discount and tiers now. With an annual membership, students can get almost a 60% discount off of a full monthly membership. Patrons at the white level or above will receive question priority. Patrons at the black level or above will receive access to extra podcast content, including extended versions of every podcast, and even perhaps in the future at some point, yet to be recorded bonus episodes. Patrons at the gold level above will receive access to unfiltered YouTube videos of our podcast each week. Follow us at on Twitter at Chasing Mac Pod or at Tech Hockey Guide. I believe, did we start a Blue Sky account yet?
If we have, then Tim has not informed me of it. Yes, we have, because
I believe we have.
That's like the one place that reliably will always post the things that we put on the website right away, despite the fact that we've had all kinds of trouble getting them on everything else. They go to Blue Sky, no problem, right away. So we are on Blue Sky.
Yeah, I have actually got, I've finally switched over, grabbed a Blue Sky, and Perry and the CCHA are doing a fantastic job of throwing highlights out there. So if you are looking for a way to get highlights every night, you know, give a good shout out there to Perry with the CCHA, who's putting them up there and doing the work on Blue Sky. And maybe he does it on Twitter. I don't know. I don't use it anymore. So
Perry is active on Blue Sky. Perry will just throw things into the ether on Twitter and then go away. So if you actually want to interact with the CCHA's Twitter account, you have to, or the Blue Sky. If you want to interact with an official at the CCHA, you should go to Blue Sky, is what I'm saying.
Yep. So Blue Sky is the way forward there. And there are other ways to support the podcast, including subscribing to the podcast on Spotify, Apple, YouTube, wherever you get your podcasts at. The more you rank, review, and share, the more people we can reach. So make sure you tell your friends. And we are continuing to do if you give us a 5-star rating, we'll read the review online. So go ahead and leave a review and we'll read it out loud. Once again, I want to thank our sponsors, Fibke Dental in Rhinelander, Wisconsin, Livonia Technical Services, Acadia Insurance, who's providing life, auto, boat, and home insurance and more to nearly all the Midwest and beyond, and our favorite hockey memorabilia shop on Whatnot, Psycho Bob TV. Finally, thanks to Thank You Notes for all the bumpers in this week's episode. If you like what you hear, check them out over at thankyounotes.bandcamp.com.
You've been listening to the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA.